Great to be back. I want to get going fast. Today we're going to look at, well, how do you respond to differences in recognition systems? I talked about recognition systems to begin yesterday. How do you respond to them? So we'll be looking today at this. How do we respond to individual differences, specifically in that area? And yesterday we ended the day with affective networks, as you know. But as Kathy said, just a quick pickup. This has been extraordinary for us in that there's so many people here who are knowledgeable about UDL that we sort of came in you already know quite a bit level. And there were some people on the feedback that said, I don't know what this is all about. And so I'm just going to dip for 4 minutes. So some of you, this is going to be really familiar. But to just give the sort of framing argument about universal design for learning. And also, because some people asked, what's the difference between it and differentiated instruction and UBD and things like that? So a little bit of framing, OK? And typically, when I'm talking about universal design for learning, I talk about the three words. What does universal mean? What does design mean? And what does learning mean? And I'm not going to do all three today. But what does universal mean, you can tell. What universal means is, how do we make education better for everybody? And that means including, and I was glad yesterday that somebody asked, it means kids who have disabilities, it means gifted kids, it means kids in the middle, it means everybody. What do we mean by learning is what we're going to be talking about these 3 days. Differentiating learning, understanding what learning really is. And so these three principles are about learning, making sure that you understand that learning is about how information is taken in, it's about how things are expressed, and it's also about how we engage students. And that's where the neuroscience of learning part is. But design is the part I just wanted to take a minute to talk about. What do we mean by design? And this is I won't say anymore. So here's the entrance. This is often the metaphor that we use at CAST. Here's the entrance to a school building. It's meant to provide access to the school, to get you in. But in fact, one of our first students, Matthew, couldn't use that method of access. He's physically disabled. He can only has motor control of his chin and his eyes. Can't use his hands, can't use his arms, legs, can't walk, talk, can't do any of those things. So this way of getting into the school, stairs are meant to be an access technology. Stairs allow people to get in the building easier. But they didn't work for Matthew. They were, in fact, a barrier. The very thing that was meant to make schools accessible for most people was a barrier for him because he was only mobile in an electric wheelchair, which he drove with his chin. And we had to teach him how to do that, but it was fabulous. He became a kid who could communicate in Morse code and drive his wheelchair with his chin, did everything with his chin, because we attached him to a computer, and he drove the computer, and it was fabulous. So that was where CAST began, actually, with that work. When he went off to school, so he now could communicate, he was mobile, the very technology that enters the school did for him. And the solution, fixing it up after, is expensive, it's ugly. You've all seen this in buildings where they've had to fix up the building after. And we do this with all sorts of things, everything from assistive technology to remedial programs to et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, special classrooms. We try to fix it up later, and it's always expensive. It's always, it's not always ugly, but it's difficult to do in an aftermarket. And one of the ways in which UDL differentiates from differentiated instruction, for example, is by the intentional design ahead of time. How do we make media materials that are designed from the beginning so that you aren't retrofitting? It's too expensive, too hard in doing differentiated instruction for teachers. There's so much homework to get ready every night and stuff to remake a curriculum which is not designed from the beginning to accommodate everybody. So here's what happened in buildings. If you try to do it afterwards, you build a building and then you say, now we need to make it accessible. That's when it's hard, difficult, and expensive. In architecture, a movement came up called universal design, which is, hey, let's make the buildings from the beginning so that everybody can use them. That turned out to be cheaper, turned out to be you could make them beautiful instead of ugly. This is the entrance to the Louvre in Paris. And here's an elevator, here's the stairs. What they did was design, again, the movement, and every architect learns universal design now. It's part of being an architect that you learn you need to make buildings that everybody can use. The sad part is that every school building is now universally designed, but our curricula are not. And the change that universal design for learning about is we need to do the same thing for the curriculum we do for the building. That is, we need to make buildings that everybody can use, we need to make a curriculum that everybody can use. Intentionally from the beginning, rather than making teachers fix it up later. So a couple of things to say about the Louvre entrance, which is nice, is that notice it isn't that there's one way to move around in the Louvre. You can take the elevator or you can take the stairs. And all of us, one of the key principles of UDL is provide choice. Some days you're going to want to use the stairs because you had a big breakfast and you want the exercise. Other days you're carrying luggage, you've got a baby carriage, whatever, you want to take the elevator. So providing alternatives is key. And you'll see in everything that we talk about in UDL, providing options, other ways to do things is the key. Not that there's one universal way to do it. So the Louvre has options. And here's some characteristics of universal designs. You design for variability from the outside. You make a building everybody can use from the beginning, so you don't have to fix it up later. You provide options and alternatives, stairs and elevators. The options benefit everyone. The fact that we have elevators, everybody likes. The fact that you have ramps everywhere means that if you have baby carriages and strollers and blah, 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 all of those things, that in fact, we can all get around the building. I always think that there should be a slight tax on luggage makers. You know, all the roller boards used to on the airplanes, none of those would be useful if there weren't ramps everywhere in the airport, because you'd have to be picking up your suitcase and lugging it up the stairs. But the fact that people with disabilities made the airport have ramps in it has made it so that the rollerboard industry flew off the handle, because everybody can assume there are ramps everywhere now, which is fabulous. So options benefit everyone. We are glad there's ramps everywhere, because we get to pull around our baby carriages and our strollers and our suitcases and all of that. So that's the idea of universal design.